So, good evening everyone.
Good evening.
Nice to see you.
Thank you.
So I think last time we were looking at the last 400 years, weren't we? And we were looking at quite a lot of heavy duty, a lot of philosophy. And European history, and perhaps that put everybody off, I don't know. But anyway.
No, it was very interesting.
Everyone liked it. Okay. All right, so we're going to carry on looking at this, looking a little bit more how this has unfolded. God's providence has unfolded just in the last, in the 20th century really, up until now. And so when we look at history, we can say that, you know, sometimes when people look at history and try and work out why did this happen, sometimes they look at, you know, all sorts of different reasons. And some of these reasons, they say, well, it's because of the economy, then that's why it had to happen. Or because of politics, that's why it had to happen, and what happened was inevitable. But also there's another dimension to history. Sometimes it's God, what happens is a result of God's providence and Satan's providence struggling to expand their dominion and to have control over human beings. So in that sense, when you look at history, you can see lots of good things have gone on, but also lots of really dreadful, terrible things have happened. And you know, for much of the history in most parts of the world, it's actually been pretty dreadful. And yes. And so some of these things are, as I said, you can explain some of these things in terms of politics, economics, ideology, and sometimes it's things which need to be gone through in order to restore something through indemnity. Just one little apology. These more recent lectures, I'm still working my way through them in terms of improving them and correcting them, wanting them to be the way I want them to be. So it's not all fitting together necessarily. So. Takes ages, you know, to be honest, making these lectures and revising them and trying to. And that's, the more early ones I showed, they were ones I've been working on for years, but these more recent ones I haven't. Anyway, so we were looking at last time, we were looking at God's providence, the foundation to receive the Messiah. You know, that God wants to be able to send the Messiah, but in order for God to send the Messiah, he has to create an environment where it's possible for the Messiah to come and for there to be a possibility that he might be successful. And also God can only send the Messiah when people have made what we call the right conditions to send the Messiah. Otherwise Satan will say, it's just not fair, you know, they don't deserve it. And so people have to do it. You know, we look at this, what's going to happen in the last days. There are lots of verses in the Bible people are often quite familiar with. During the last days, there'll be wars and all sorts of terrible calamities will take place. Famines and earthquakes and nation rising against nation, kingdom against kingdom, great distress, etc. So it's going to be a very, not an easy time.
But surely that's already here now.
Yes. That's what some people would say. So that's what we're looking at, these sort of things. So, you know, some of these things happened in the last century, some of the worst wars in human history. Yes, and I told you about the 30 Years' War, which was pretty dreadful. You know, a huge proportion of the population of Europe perished in these religious wars. Often people have forgotten about them now. I think somebody tried to get in over there. Not quite sure who it is. And so when we look at these world wars, hello, come in, welcome. Good evening, sorry, we only just started, so you haven't missed very much. You can either have a hard seat or a comfortable seat, it's up to you.
Sorry,
yes, I would have done the same. Nice comfy chair. Okay, so when we look at these world wars, we're going to be looking at the First, Second, Third World Wars. We could say they're part of Satan's struggle, last struggle to prevent God from taking dominion over the world. So Satan wanted to establish and keep control over human beings. Yeah. And so these world wars were Satan's last attempt to do this. And so Satan then has his own providence. So those of you who are here when we're looking at the story of Adam and Eve and the fall of man, we talked about how Lucifer had his own ideas about how he could organize human society better than God could. He had his own plans, in that sense, his own providence. Good evening. Welcome. We only just started, so I guess I can always start again or backtrack a little bit. Comfy chairs or harder ones? Well, take your pick. You want a front seat, huh? In the stalls. Cheaper seats are the stalls. So. There's plenty of leg room. Anyway, so just explaining that we're just looking now at these at the world wars and trying to understand what was going on during the 20th century in the world wars and what was and part of it was to do with Satan trying to establish his ideal, Satan trying to express and manifest his idea of how human society should be. And so we examine and we look at these kind of societies, we can see what was Satan's vision for Adam and Eve and for human history and prevent God from establishing his creation. But Satan then had his own vision of, in terms of the three blessings on a false Adam. We'll look at this, a false multiplication, a false dominion. And as it says there, I'll just reiterate my little apology, I'm still working my way through these slides, so they haven't revised them and made them the way I really want them to be. So some of the things are a bit awkward. So that's part of it, Satan's struggle to preserve his sovereignty and establish his kind of vision of what he thinks is an ideal society. Another cause of these wars is to overcome Jesus' temptations on a worldwide level. So again, we looked before at Jesus' temptations, so we'll see how this fits. The kind of temptations that were faced and were offered to people and that Britain and America had to overcome on a worldwide level. And also it's a sort of indemnity condition to restore the three blessings and worldwide restoration of the Cain and Abel conflict. So sometimes when we talk about an Abel side and a Cain side, and sometimes you think, well, one is good and one is bad. But actually, good evening, come in, sit down. You're welcome. Sometimes people think, well, one side's good and one side's bad, and all the things that one side good does is, all the things that one side does are good, and all the things that another side does are bad. But actually, Cain and Abel, they're just relative positions. One is relatively better than the other. Neither of them is completely black, and neither of them is completely white. It's just a relative thing. One's relatively better than the other. So the Abel side is relatively better in the sense that it supports God's providence and creating the kind of society where it's possible for people to manifest and develop the three blessings. In other words, you have to have the freedom to pursue one's original mind, the freedom to realize the three blessings, and also the freedom in order to be for the Messiah to come and where a new truth can come about without the person bringing the new truth ending up being killed. And the Cain side is relatively worse. Relatively speaking, it tends more to block God's providence and also tends to be a lack of freedom to be able to respond to God. So, in this world level restoration, generally speaking, the Cain side attacks first. So the one who's the one more aggressive and attacks first, is generally speaking, we can say on the Cain side. And the Abel side generally gains victory through self-sacrifice, through first being attacked and then going and putting itself together, pulling its socks up, and going and fighting back. And so responsibility of Cain and Abel. Well, Abel's responsibility, first of all, is not to give in to Cain. In other words, not to allow himself to be intimidated, and particularly not allow himself to be killed. So self-defense is a good thing. To defend oneself, to love Cain, and also to show Cain a better way of behaving, a better way of organizing society, a better way of living. Hi, Margaret. And then Cain's responsibility is to receive Abel's support and guidance. So as I said, I'm still working on trying to develop the wording. There's a bit more. So one of the interesting things when we look at this, it's all to do with the restoration of Adam's family, ultimately. But with Adam and Eve, there was just Adam and Eve and the archangel. And as we know, the archangel seduced Eve and Eve seduced Adam, and they came under the dominion of Satan, of the archangel. So all these things need to be restored. So when we look in the Old Testament history, we saw how these things have been restored on a greater and greater level. And finally now, this restoration expanded from the family level up to the worldwide level. And so now you have different nations representing these different figures and different roles from the Bible. So you have an Adam nation, an Eve nation, an archangel nation on a worldwide level. And then you could talk about a clash then between an Abel block or group of nations and a Cain block or group of nations. And this restoration has to come about such that there can be reconciliation and there can be peace. Yeah, and the Cain side can be wedded away from their evil form of government and it can be replaced by a good form of government. Anyway, as per usual, if you want to stop and interrupt me, then please do. So, well, thanks. Okay, so we look at the First World War, which started in 1914. You know, when you read the history books, it talks about there's Archduke Ferdinand, who was the Austrian heir to the throne, as far as I remember. Anyway, he was traveling through Serbia, and then he was assassinated. And then the Austro-Hungarians were really upset with the Serbians, and they started to mobilize their armies to go and occupy and declare war on Serbia. And then Serbia said help and asked Russia, who was their ally, to come and help them. So Russia mobilized. And Austria-Hungary said, well, we can't take on Russia by ourselves. We need the Germans on our side. And then Germany became involved. And then France became involved because France was there to support Russia. And then England became caught up with the whole thing. And so the whole of Europe then became involved in this, you know, dreadful thing. And so I was just thinking when Serbia beat Germany 1-0, it was a belated revenge. Sorry?
Did they not make this Archduke Ferdinand an excuse to perhaps bring conflict?
Well, yes, but you know, they were kind of upset about this.
What did he actually do? Well,
okay, so Serbia at that time is part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. But the Serbians, they're naturally, they're Slavs and they're Orthodox. And so the natural loyalty and alliance and cultural identity is with the Slavic people, the Russians. But they were part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, so they felt like they'd been occupied by a bunch of foreigners. And so when the local representative of the foreign ruler came along, then they thought, well, this is a good chance to knock him off. And then one thing led to another, you know, and just one treaty came into action that led to another treaty coming into action, another one, and eventually, you know, they ended up, almost accidentally, the whole of Europe ended up tearing itself apart. It's the worst disaster that happened to Europe.
No one really knew what they were fighting about.
Sorry?
No,
they were just honouring the alliances and treaties that they had to support one another, basically. And once it started, you couldn't stop it. Once Russia started to mobilise, you know, it's not like today to send out an email message. You know, once the message went out, it took weeks for the message to happen and for the mobilisation to happen. Once you started, you couldn't stop it. You couldn't turn a clock back. And once somebody found out you were mobilizing, they thought, well, we better start mobilizing before they get mobilized. And that's the way it was. And there's no, you know, hotline to the White House in those days. So that's, you know, and it was the whole of Europe then became involved in this. And also because of the European empires, then basically the whole world became involved in this. And so basically, you had two sides. You had on the Allied side, they had Russia and England and France. And the central axis sides, you had Germany, Austria-Hungary, and Turkey. These were their allies.
That's in Europe, but then you had, of course, the others, Russia, America.
Well, America came in later,
yeah.
As per usual. Sorry, I hope nobody from America is listening.
We were actually with France, not against them. That's amazing.
That was interesting. So historically, Britain has been involved in maintaining the balance of power in Europe. And so historically, France was the dominant, for a long time, France was the dominant, the strongest country. Because Germany, because of what the Catholic Church did to Germany, it was broken up into lots of principalities. But through Bismarck, gradually they started to, you know, because they didn't, anyway, they were defeated by Napoleon, who imposed all sorts of stuff upon them, And they decided they didn't want to be humiliated like this again. And the only way they could do it was to create a Germany. Before it, there was Prussia, and Prussia was an ally of England, and there was the Saxe-Coburgs and all sorts of different, you know, states. So they decided, let's put all the pieces back together again. And that's what Bismarck did. And then Germany then became a powerful nation and actually became more powerful than France. And then Britain realized, actually, our natural ally was Germany, but Germany's now so powerful it can dominate the continent, so Britain then changes ally with France to support France. Switzerland's neutral, and the others are just bit players, to be honest. Just, you know, the armies, it's just like the road to from Germany to France happens to go through Belgium. You know, just the way it is. So they don't have much of a say in that sense, not in the 20th century. I mean, days gone by, you know, Sweden at one stage was the most powerful country in Europe. You know, other days, other times, it was Spain was the most powerful country. So, you know, everybody's had its, every country's had its day in the sun. Yeah, the First World War then, it's the false messiah, attempt to realize the three blessings centered upon an evil purpose. And so you have this false Adam, people talk about Kaiser Wilhelm II. And he's a rather arrogant person, and he thought a lot of himself, and he saw himself as a person who should be the Holy Roman Emperor, and, you know, the recovery of Germany, and all these sort of visions from the past, and had a vision of pan-Germanism, a sort of early sort of, you know, version of Nazism, I suppose, and had this vision of world domination. And anyway, so some people were tempted to go along with that, ally themselves with that. And here are a few quotes to prove that I'm not making all this up. Kaiser Wilhelm II, third German emperor, said, "Germany's greatness makes it impossible for her to do without the ocean, but the ocean also proves that even in the distance and on the farther side, without Germany and the German emperor, no great decision dare henceforth be taken." In other words, Germany should have a veto over all the decisions that are now taken in Europe and outside Europe as well. You know, Germany should be the decisive voice in world affairs. "Our German fatherland, to which I hope will be granted to become in the future as closely united, as powerful and as authoritative as once the Roman world empire was. But just as in the old times they said, 'Civis Romanus sum,' I am a Roman citizen, hereafter, at some time in the future, they will say, 'I am a German citizen.'" In other words, all the people living in Europe will think, "I'm a German citizen." So that's what he said. Anyway, so we got this sort of lineup then, and we have on the able side, representing the Adam position, there was Russia. And again, Russia had this extraordinary history and saw itself as, also had certain visions as well, that through Russia the world would be saved and all sorts of, you know, very interesting things. And so Russia then was in the Adam position in God's providence. England was in the Eve position in God's providence, and France in the Archangel position in God's providence. And you can see this is not just something arbitrary, assignment. You can actually see that England, do English people talk about the fatherland? No, the motherland, mother country. So the archetypal images of England are, and Britain generally, are feminine. You have Britannia as a woman. You know, it's always, you know, you can go back thousands of years, that's a sort of archetypal spirit or image of England as the mother country. And Russia sees itself in that sense also. But interesting, Russia calls itself Mother Russia, so it doesn't fit exactly. But certainly Germany sees itself as the fatherland, sees itself as a masculine Adam kind of country. And Austria-Hungary in that, I'm not sure, is that spelled right? It's just my stomach rumbling. Thinking it must be a misspelling. Anyway, it's Austria-Hungary. So again, if you look at the sort of symbols and images for Austria, also they're rather feminine. And then France is an archangel position. Archangels and intellectual, and the French all intellectuals. And Turkey is an archangel position there. And so that was the sort of lineup in terms of Adam's family. And they mobilized, all went off to war. And then in 1917, there was the revolution in Russia. And I don't want to go into the background of it, But basically, Russia was on God's side, but there were certain reasons why it was that communists were able to seize power and take over in Russia. And if you look at Russian history, you can see there are many times where Russia had a choice between going in one direction or another direction, and it would make go in the wrong direction. So over a period of time, more and more bad conditions are made so that it's possible for Satan to claim Russia in that sense, of the Bolsheviks to take over. And so then, one of the first things the Bolsheviks did is they withdrew from, they made peace with Germany, they withdrew from the war, which meant that Germany now had peace on its eastern flank and now could, you know, dedicate all its forces to the west. And then, fortunately, the cavalry came in, and that was America, joined, and to replace Russia as the Adam position on God's providence. And that was the line up there. And really, it was, you know, just absolutely a horrendous war. Europe really never recovered from this war. You know, millions of, countless millions of people died. I mean, it's just one person, counts of millions of people died. And in Britain, in particular, it was the finest people died. Mm. Because Britain, until 1917, Britain didn't have a conscript army. It was a volunteer army. And so for the first few years, the people who were soldiers and went to war, these are the people who volunteered. They were the most patriotic people, who, for the sake of their country, volunteered and joined the army. And the people who weren't so patriotic stayed at home, or, I guess. And so, yes, the finest of the whole generations wiped out, the finest people. And you can see, you know, the war memorials. And so, for example, my grandfather, after he went to university in Oxford, and then he went to work in Burma. And anyway, when the war started, he's, you know, said, should I come back and join up? And they said, no, because the work you're doing is very important. You know, the sort of work he was doing is very important for the war effort, raw materials and things. They said, don't come back. Anyway, after the war finished, he came home back to England, and there wasn't a single person, he didn't have a single friend from university, from school. Every single person he knew had been killed. And so he just felt it was just, you know, nobody. And so then he went off to live in Australia. So, you know, it's really, Europe never recovered from the First World War. Anyway, the First World War ended with the defeat of the defeat of Germany, Austria and Hungary, and Turkey. And the result of this was peace and establishment of the League of Nations. And so, in this sense, it was, as I said, this is, a lot of this is to do with overcoming the first temptation. So, Britain then had a choice. Britain could either go to war with Germany, against Germany, or Britain could have just stayed out of it. So Britain had no interest in Germany in one sense. Britain had no colonies in Europe. Britain had no border with Europe. Britain had a vast empire. A quarter of the population of the world was ruled by Britain. So Britain could have said, okay, you lot, you can go and fight it out, and we're just going to carry on doing this. So, but Britain then, because Germany didn't want to go to war with Britain at all, actually. Yeah, Britain then overcame this temptation. Also, America could have said, well, it's just the Europeans, you know, carrying on as normal, having their wars. Why should we get involved? And again, it's a temptation not to get involved. You know, they're just, why should we, it's not our war, why should we get involved? But for whatever reason, Britain and America felt this is the moral thing to do. It's not in our interest to get involved, because war is incredibly damaging and destructive, but it's the right thing to do. Just like Britain got involved to defeat Napoleon, it's the right thing to do. You know, we could have allowed Napoleon to run the whole of Europe. Yeah, but again, at huge cost in terms of money, treasure, and lives, we defeated Napoleon. Anyway, so it's the restoration of the first blessing. So it's also made the condition of enmity for the Messiah to be born. Yeah? So the Allies side, instead of staying out of it, Britain and America became involved. And so because of this, then the Cain-Abel relationship was restored. The Cain side was defeated, and democracy then was established in much of Europe. And so that's the foundation of substance was established at great cost. And that was the foundation in order for the Messiah to be born. That was the price that was paid. Another result of the First World War was that lots of empires were broken up. So for example, Austria-Hungary, that the Austria-Hungarian Empire was broken up. And so now we have lots of little countries in Eastern Europe, Romania, Bulgaria, Austria, Hungary, Yugoslavia. Well, Yugoslavia is not there anymore. All the bits of Yugoslavia. And they all used to be one empire. So, you know, there's an idea of national independence, that every country should govern and rule itself. Yeah, and people should be responsible for the decisions that are made within their own country.
You said the Keynes side was defeated.
Yeah.
Normally, you say that's not really the goal of this relationship.
Well, if necessary.
And is the League of Nations that came out of it sort of an idea that they could have come together more?
Yes, so there was the idea that people...
Germany's such a hard time.
Well, the idea was that the League of Nations was, let's set up a sort of talking place where we can resolve these things without having to go to war. Because when it happened, people recognised, you know, there's a saying, the lights went out in Europe. You know, the intelligent people all over Europe realised this is an absolute disaster. We've been trying to stop this from happening through all these alliances and the balance of peace, and it happened. And so they thought there must be, you know, an institution which we can establish to try and prevent such a thing from happening again. So that became the basis of the League of Nations for the sake of peace. And how could it have been resolved any differently? Well, if the Archduke hadn't have been killed, then it wouldn't have started there. But it's possible that, you know, everything was set up. It's possible that something else might have caused it or sparked it off. And there was a sense that of unintended consequences. You know, the person who shot the Archduke, they weren't planning the World War. It's just one thing led to another. Sort of a certain logic was set in motion. It's like you knock over and, you know, bonk, and that's what happened. And so, you know, it's the kind of foundation for the Messiah to be born. So the result of the First World War, then the Austria-Hungarian Empire was broken up, but also the Ottoman Empire was broken up. So that was Turkey and the Ottoman Empire. So the Ottoman Empire had been around for about 1,000 years. That controlled what's now Turkey, most of the Middle East, you know, bits of it have been sort of disappearing over the years. But basically, when you lose the war, then somebody else redraws the map. And so the maps of Europe and the map of the Middle East was redrawn after the First World War by the people who won the war, basically. And so Germany became a bit smaller. Austria is now a tiny little place. You know, the countries that lost land. Yeah? They lost their sovereignty. And, you know, and then it was decided at the Treaty of Versailles to create a homeland for the Jewish people. And so that's the Balfour Declaration, which is issued in 1915, I think it was. And then, so the Ottoman Empire was broken up and these modern countries were created, such as Iraq, Iran, Syria, Lebanon, Israel, Palestine, all these, you know, new countries were created in the Middle East. And, there is Treaty of Versailles. So there's all sorts of problems went on there. Germany itself didn't feel that it had been defeated because no Allied armies went into and occupied Germany. So the Germans thought, well, we didn't lose. You know, basically they felt it was a stalemate. But the actual Treaty of Versailles, the French demanded reparations. So Woodrow Wilson, when he came over, he had a certain idealistic basis for establishing peace, which included the breakup of the Austro-Hungarian, these empires was an American initiative. You know, had
but
some...
they did make lots of rules and regulations. For example, Germany wasn't allowed to...
That's right.
Any,
but that's right. Yep. Loads of things, yes.
Yeah. So in a way, that was a way of saying, you know...
Well, that's
lost.
Right. Well, that's right. And so the Germans felt...
Well, some
yes, right. So Germany didn't feel that it had lost, but then the Treaty of Versailles, those huge reparations, in other words, the Germans had to pay vast amounts of money, basically to rebuild France, and the French weren't willing to allow the Germans off. They said, "We want the money to rebuild France. And so, as I said, so when the Germans saw the treaty, they felt, this isn't fair, you know, it wasn't all our fault. You know, everybody got involved, you know, and we didn't lose. They felt it was a stalemate. And so this led to a certain amount of resentment and the sense of, you know, somebody stabbed us in the back. Whose fault was it that, you know, thing went wrong? And so this led to resentment, to rise of nationalism, and all sorts of the depression, you know, inflation, and searching to put the blame on somebody. It wasn't our fault. Who can we blame? And they ended up blaming the Jews. Anyway, League of Nations worked out okay, but America wasn't part of it, so it didn't work very well. And then you have this sort of second attempt then. And so of these two wars, which one do you think was the most significant? The First World War or the Second World War?
First World War.
Why? You're right, yeah. Why do you think?
Why? Because there was no meaning behind it. I've seen so many documentaries on it. I don't know about the other countries, but for example, all the young men that were sent off to war, they didn't even know why they were fighting.
Young men usually don't, but they just feel it's their patriotic duty.
And also the fact that, you know, Christmas Eve, and they all stop, put their guns down, and they all play football, smoke each other's cigarettes, laugh and joke, and then the next day,
war,
they up with their guns again and killing one another. It was all just meaningless.
Right. Anyway, in terms of significance, I'm thinking more about how the world was changed. The First World War changed the world unimaginably. The Second World War was just finishing off the unfinished business of the Second World War. And so if you want to understand the world, you need to understand the First World War is much more significant than the Second World War.
Because all the... Hitler was also born.
Yes, but anyway, in the Second World War, you have this sort of... need to rework all these slides. This false messiah, again, another attempt to realize the three blessings centered upon an evil purpose. So the false messiah here was Adolf Hitler. And Adolf Hitler had certain views about himself, which I'll look at in a moment. And this sort of multiplication, this is a Nazism. So you may know the Germans were into eugenics. In other words, into breeding people. And so they thought that, you know, there's sort of racial categories. From the highest are the white people with blue eyes and blonde hair. You know, then there's the white people with blue eyes and brown hair, and a whole categorization all the way down, they said, to people from Africa, black people. So they had this sort of vision about how things are organized. And so then they wanted to multiply, get involved in all sorts of eugenics and get rid of all what they regarded as the lower races, and wanted to multiply, people with blue eyes and blonde hair. So they had a whole program of getting lots of Swedish women along and impregnating them and trying to. The whole thing's actually pretty horrendous, to be honest. Anyway, also in terms of dominion, they wanted to create a new Europe, a united Europe with a fascist kind of government. And as a world dominion. And you can look at here, again, you had these sort of, again, it's to do with the restoration of Adam's family. On the Adam's position, you had America. Eve's position, you had Britain again. And Archangel position, France again. And on the Cain side, this time you had Adam's position was Germany, the Eve position was Japan, the Archangel position was Italy. And so it was a general, a worldwide conflict, again, which consumed much of the world. And they got Mussolini and Hitler. And you can see something, about the sort of way they were thinking. So this is Mussolini. He said, "I send greetings to all my followers. I am Il Duce, your great leader. I'm like a god. I've done so much for all the Italian people." So again, you can see this cult of the personality. I'm like a god. In other words, I'm like a new Caesar, because in the Roman Empire, the Caesar were regarded as being gods. So again, it's a throwback to Nimrod. For those,
yeah, she's saying I'm like a god.
I didn't make this up. I mean, I'm just assuming. I'm assuming it's a good translation. So let's have a look at Adolf Hitler. There he is. I'm the greatest leader of all time. I have great plans. This is one of his plans. Soon there'll be a special German church where the Bible is replaced by my book called Mein Kampf. The cross will be replaced by a sword. But that's actually, you might think, well, this is just, you know, like a pipe dream. But actually, there is a church in Germany which is full of Nazi symbols because that was his program. And he actually started that. Oh, it's just his vision of how the world is ought to be. Nazi, fascist. It's like a, you know, it's a political pamphlet, except it's rather a thick one. Anyway, so that was, you know, you can see here how this is really on the satanic side in that sense. He wanted to completely replace Christianity. So Hitler wasn't, he didn't like the Jews, but also he didn't like Christianity because Christianity, the founder of Christianity was a Jew. And so it's very interesting if you look at German theology and biblical scholarship. During the 19th century, the anti-Semitism, which one found within the German Lutheran Church, moved towards trying to remove the idea that Jesus was a Jew. So, for example, historically, the oldest gospel in the New Testament has been regarded as Matthew. That's why it's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That's historically, the Catholic Church has always taught Matthew as the oldest gospel. But also Matthew is the most Jewish gospel. You can see from Matthew, Jesus is born, lived, and died a Jew. He's as, you know, Jewish as you can get. And so it's a very uncomfortable, you know, a lot of Christians don't like the idea that Jesus was a Jew. Anyways, the German biblical scholarship came up with a new idea, was that Mark was the oldest gospel. But actually, when you read Mark, it is known to have been written in Rome, and it's the least Jewish of the Gospels. And so when you study Mark, Jesus comes across not as being particularly Jewish, but as, you know, sort of something else. You can actually read all sorts of ideas into who Jesus is in the Gospel of Mark. And then they said the Gospel of Matthew is based upon the Gospel of Mark. In other words, all this Jewish stuff was added on later, and in the sense you can dismiss it as being inauthentic and, you know, not original, that Mark is the original, oldest gospel, and all the other stuff is just extra bits that were added on.
There's two contradictions already in what Adolf has said to be. Firstly, he's not blonde and blue-eyed.
No.
And also,
he's a bit short. I know, lots of contradictions. He wasn't German, he's Austrian. And actually, later on, it's from actually Austria. It was actually a far more anti-Semitic country than Germany. And it was the Austrians who took the lead in manning the concentration camps and all these things. It's very much an Austrian, disproportionately involved in the extermination of Jews and anti-Semitism. Yes, I mean, there's some suggestion he might have been partly Jewish himself. Interesting, he went to the same school as Wittgenstein. You heard of Wittgenstein? Anyway, I'll leave Wittgenstein out of it. You know. But, you know, he had a certain kind of charisma, such that when people spoke, people were, you know, and set up all these amazing Nuremberg rallies. And there he would be, you know, right up the front there speaking with his vast loudspeakers and everything. And, you know, it's just the personality cult, yeah, which is, yeah, not right. Anyway, so he had this war, and this time the Allies, there was America, England and France on the Able side, and Germany, Japan and Italy on the Keynes side, the Axis powers. And then the USSR had made a treaty, not the Biden-Meinhof, what's it called? The Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, so that Germany and the USSR, Soviet Union, agreed not to invade each other, but they decided to divide Poland up between the two of them. And then actually, so Germany didn't want to go to war with England, because Germans thought, Hitler thought, well, the English, they're just Germans. So for example, when I go to Germany and people say, do you speak German? I say, yes, I speak the Anglo-Saxon dialect. I keep people awake somehow. Anyway, so, you know, the English came from the same sort of geographical area as Germany. And so Hitler saw us as we're all part of the Germanic people. And he saw England as being the natural ally of Germany, because historically England was a natural ally of Germany, of Prussia against France. And so he didn't want to go to war with Britain at all. His vision and his whole motivation was to go to move east, to invade the Slav countries. So he wanted to make a treaty with Britain. But Britain refused to make a treaty with Germany. Anyway, so Germany ended up making a treaty with Russia, because Germany realized it couldn't fight on two fronts at the same time. So made a treaty together with Russia. And so, anyway, Britain decided to guarantee Poland's border. You know, you might wonder why, but that's what we did.
Because they're not blonde and
blue. No, so it didn't really fit into the scheme. But there was, but in terms of the government, style of government, yeah, it was rather militaristic and fascist at that time, and so it formed a natural ally, you know, against... Japan at that time has been squeezed by the United States. You know, quite often the United States foreign policy is profoundly and deeply hypocritical. And, you know, often just push, you know, the way in which the Americans work. And so they were squeezing Japan and pushing Japan into an impossible situation. And then Japan ended up, you know, coming out. They felt squeezed, they had to do something. They felt the only way they could get out of this situation was to attack America. Then they became allied with Germany, of course, and Britain joined. It became involved like this. Didn't need to become involved, but it just felt it had no way out, I guess. Anyway, so it was Britain that declared war on Germany. Germany didn't declare war on Britain. Britain guaranteed Poland's border and told Germany, if you invade Poland, then we will declare war on you. And so Germany invaded Poland, and then Britain declared war on Germany. And again, so there's a huge temptation here. Britain could have thought, well, we got this vast empire. Why should we get involved in European politics and European war again? You know, why don't we just make an alliance with Germany, and, you know, we'll allow Germany to rule Europe, and then Germany will allow us to rule the rest of the world. So that was and there were serious groups in Britain that thought Britain should make an alliance with Germany. Yeah. So it's like a temptation, yeah, not to get involved in this way. I think, you know, we're the same race, we can rule the world together. But Britain, you know, to its credit, decided to go to war with Germany, recognizing that it would cost Britain its empire. And anyway, it cost Britain its empire. Yes, I mean, the cost of fighting the war was Britain lost its empire. Britain became reduced to poverty. You know, Britain is now a minor country in the world. Well, relatively minor, still in the top 10, the Premier League. But, you know, but... But before the First World War, Britain was number one in the world in terms of wealth, trade, everything. Manufacturing was number one. Before the Second World War, it was still, you know, right up there. But, you know, after the Second World War, it was, you know, completely bankrupted, basically. You know, yes, basically, Britain after the Second World War was bankrupt. Its deficit, you know, we talk about a high deficit now, but then it was 250%. You know, far more in debt than it is today. And it took Britain 50, 60 years to pay off the debts that it had to America to fight the Second World War, because America didn't, you know, offer free aid. You know, all these battleships and everything, they were bought. We didn't have the money to buy them, so it just went into debt, vast debts to America in order to be able to afford to defeat Germany. As a result of that, we were bankrupt. And then it took, as I said, 50 years to repay these debts. It's interesting, actually. Anyway, so you had this war, and again, it was dreadful, awful, you know, the number of people that were killed. And, you know, again, it involved much of the world. And also it involved the Jews in Europe. So part of the policy of Hitler was, interesting enough, to try and exterminate the Jews. Part of the reason was, it felt that The Jews in Germany, no one, you know, if you look, there's 500,000 Jews living in Germany. In Britain, there were 300,000 Jews. So there were no more Jews living in Germany than were in Britain in terms of proportion. And sometimes you ask Germans, they say, oh, well, there were lots of Jews living in Germany, it took over everything. But actually, there were the same proportion of Jews living in this country, but there wasn't the anti-Semitism in this country towards there was in Germany. So all the heights of German science, industry, culture, poetry, you know, all the people right at the very top in universities are all, generally speaking, are Jewish people. So Hitler, Churchill, if you want to know one of his sort of asides, you know, he's talking to somebody called Weizmann, I think, who was a Zionist leader, and said, no, there's no anti-Semitism in Britain. Because the Jews aren't better than us. In other words,
we've got an inferiority complex.
Sorry? British people didn't have an inferiority complex. You know, they didn't feel like these people had taken over our country because they didn't. You know, the British were just as well represented in all these cultural spheres. Anyway, so you can see vast numbers of Jewish people here, 3 million in Poland. And the Jews are the oldest extant living community in Europe. Yeah? You know what I mean by that? Before the Germans even thought of themselves as Germans, there were Jews living in Europe. Yeah, Jews have been living in Europe for more than 2,000 years. You know, during the time of the Roman Empire, 10% of the Roman Empire was Jewish. You know, before any of these nations even had an idea of being a nation, what idea of being a people, the Jewish people were living in Europe. Yeah, so it's very interesting. But certain Europeans started to think that Jews aren't Europeans, but actually in reality they've been living there for much longer. So they're trying to sort of block them out of their history. And as I said, for example, and up until today you read history books about European history, you very rarely will you ever notice that there are Jews there. But it's very interesting they've been written out of European history. Anyway, so there they were. Then, 1933, Hitler came to power. It was Kristallnacht, and he told all the Jews they should leave. And so you can see vast numbers of Jewish people emigrated. They left Germany. They went all around the world, you know, even to Shanghai and China, and lots came to Britain and elsewhere. But anyway, so during the war then, Hitler started the Holocaust to try and get rid of all the Jewish people in Germany. But then when they occupied Poland, there were 3 million Jews living in Poland. So, you know, and then when he went in the Soviet Union, there's another 2 million living there. So this desire to have land where Germany could expand. So Hitler wanted to expand Germany, yes? Because he said, it's not fair, you know, Britain has expanded and taken over, you know, most of the world. We need space as well. Sorry? Anyway, so he said, we need space, you know, we don't want to go to the west because France is there, we've had a big enough fight with them, but instead we want to move east. You know, there's plenty of space in the east. But then when we went there, we found a lot of Jewish people living there. And so he started to try and get rid of them, and so led to the Holocaust. And you can see here that image in the center there is Auschwitz. And that's just the entrance. A train line goes in. At the end of the train line is a gas chamber. And when you look at it, you see it, it's on an industrial scale. There were hundreds, I don't know if there were hundreds. It's like a huge, tens of acres of huts in which people were put. And then they were gradually worked to death and exterminated and gassed. And you can see the bodies there. That's how they used to sleep and live in that thing on the left there. And yeah, then they'd just been arbitrarily shot there. And they were always stripped of their clothes and their hair was cut off. So they were dehumanized. Yeah? Their humanity was taken away and then put in an oven to be burnt. Anyway, so Samuel Moon, he spoke about this. He said the Holocaust was a Cain-inspired action, one of Hitler's satanic designs and plans, which should have been prevented by a unified front of all Christian and Jewish forces. So you think about it, this is the Cain killing Abel, on a racial, on a religious scale. Yeah, it's the murder of Abel by Cain. And when you look at European history, you know, and you actually study the contribution of Jewish people through European history, it's been completely disproportionate to their numbers in the field of literature, art, culture, finance, business. A huge contribution they made to Europe, the literature and all sorts of things. But anyway, there's a lot of envy, as I said, towards Jewish people because they seem to be so successful, and some people felt very envious, and envy is a sort of Cain-type kind of reaction. But also a lot of anti-Semitism, which an anti-Semitic kind of environment which is created by the Christian church. So historically, you know, the Christian church blamed the Jews for killing Jesus. When the Christian church was microscopic, and I say the Jewish Judaism as a religion was huge within the Roman Empire. It was a huge world religion at that time. You know, it was the religion of Rome, because the Romans just basically, you know, worshipped idols, a bunch of pagans. And, well, they were. Anyway, but then when Jesus was killed, and then the early church, I mean, all the followers of Jesus were Jews. All the leaders of the Christian church the first 2 centuries were Jews. They were Jews who believed in Jesus. So Jews who believed in Jesus felt that it was knew that it was a mistake that Jesus had been killed. But then they didn't want to, you know, they realized this is wrong. And so they blamed their fellow Jews and saying, you know, it's all your fault that Jesus wasn't accepted. And also some interesting things happened. Are you interested in this sort of thing? Yeah, you might wonder, why do Christians believe that Jesus is supposed to be put to death? It's a mystery, isn't it? You know, it seems so illogical. Well, the reason is because the early church, in other words, the Jews who believed Jesus as the Messiah, they were trying to persuade other Jews that Jesus is the Messiah. But the Jews who didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah, they said Jesus couldn't have been the Messiah because he was killed. The Messiah is supposed to sit on the throne of David. The Messiah is supposed to liberate Israel. The Messiah is supposed to bring world peace. Jesus didn't sit on the throne of David. He didn't liberate Israel. He didn't bring world peace. Therefore, and he was killed, so he couldn't have been the Messiah. Okay, problem. So what do you think the Jews who believed in Jesus did to try to persuade the Jews who didn't believe in Jesus that Jesus really was the Messiah, even though he was killed? What was their witnessing strategy to overcome this argument?
Prophecies in the Old Testament.
And he had to die.
Yes, so they had to say Jesus was the Messiah even though he was killed, because he was actually fulfilling these prophecies in the Old Testament. So that's why they came up with this argument that Jesus is supposed to die, because they were trying to persuade, even though they knew he wasn't supposed to die, they were trying to persuade other Jews that even though he did die, he was still the Messiah. And actually, instead of fulfilling the glorious prophecies, which he should have fulfilled, he fulfilled these other ones instead. Yeah? And so that came up as a witnessing strategy, you know, which had all sorts of long-term consequences. So before we start changing, you know, things, we should think, what are the implications of this? This is me that changes it, of course.
Changing what's that?
Ideas.
Such as?
I haven't got one in my head at the moment. But, you know, I mean, okay, I mean, in any religion, yeah, sometimes people change ideas. Anyway, so this idea developed, and there was a sort of residual blame. And so the little Christian church, there are very few people, you know, mind you, 60 years after Jesus died, there are more Jews who believed that Jesus is a Messiah than there are Koreans who believe that Sun Myung-moon is a Messiah today.
Say that again.
60 years after Jesus died, there were more Jews who believed Jesus was a Messiah than there are Koreans who believe Sun Myung-moon is a Messiah today. You know what I mean? Yeah, so many Jews accepted Jesus as a Messiah. Yeah, it wasn't that he, you know, so if you actually look at the stories, you can see that Jesus, generally speaking, was welcomed by the Jewish people. Crowds of people followed him. When he went into Jerusalem, people were cheering. They weren't jeering, they were cheering. You know, when they wanted to arrest him, they couldn't arrest him in the temple because all the crowds were following him and going after him. So generally speaking, the Jewish people received and accepted Jesus. But there were some political leaders, the temple authorities, who were worried that Jesus would be accepted by everybody, and then it would lead to a rebellion and a revolt against the Romans, and they realized, we haven't got the soldiers. The Romans will come down on us like a ton of bricks, and they'll destroy our holy place, they'll destroy Jerusalem. You can, this is what it says, you read it in the Gospel of John. The reasons for the high priest saying, Jesus needs to die, because if he doesn't die, then everybody will go after Jesus, and the Romans will come and destroy Jerusalem and destroy the temple. Yeah? Okay, that's what it actually says. If you actually read it, that's what it says. Not that the Jews rejected Jesus, but actually Jesus was killed by the Romans as a political revolutionary and subversive. And that's why when he was killed, the sign above his head was King of the Jews. When he went into Jerusalem, they shouted, Hosanna, to the king, the son of David. You know, so the Romans heard this, what his disciples were saying, that he was proclaiming him as the Messiah and the son of David. The Messiah was a political title. And so Jesus then was seen as a political threat. I mean, Jesus wasn't the first Messiah that the Romans had killed or executed. They just executed messiahs for, you know, breakfast, basically. No, once when they wanted to make him the king, he said no. He also told his disciples not to proclaim that he was the Messiah. But actually they did start doing that. A similar thing happened in Father's early life, when Father had this sort of people who followed him from Yewa? What's the university called? Yewa? Anyway, right. So Father told them, don't go around proclaiming and telling everybody all this stuff, and that I'm the Messiah and this, that and the other, because it'll cause endless headaches for me. But actually they did go around, you know, they're so excited, they went around telling everybody. And as a result of that, you know, the university authorities became upset and they were kicked out and everything, all the problems started from there. Whereas the father actually said, don't go around telling people this. Yeah? You know, because father was very politically astute. Yes, anyway, all the problems started there. Anyway, so the reality is, but Christianity then, if Christians went around saying it's the Romans' fault that Jesus was killed, then this wasn't very good PR. If they wanted, because then they'd also be seen as anti-Roman. And so even though when you read the Gospels, it's very clear, but the general Christian reading and understanding is that the Jews rejected Jesus and the Jews killed Jesus. Okay? And so this then led to the sort of development of a sort of anti-Semitism. And then also, Christians then would carry on witnessing to Jews and became very upset when Jews weren't following Jesus. And then Christianity developed the sense of we're the new Israel and the old Israel has failed. The old Israel shouldn't be there anymore. All these Jews should become Christians and follow Jesus. But the Jews carried on being Jews, not following Jesus. But then they were doing really well and they're really prosperous. But they're supposed to be cursed by God. But actually they were wealthy and prosperous and creative and also, you know. And so the Christianity church got the state to impose one restriction upon another, restriction upon another, restriction upon another, restriction upon the Jews, till in the end they were pushed into ghettos. And they weren't allowed to own land, they weren't allowed to engage in business or in agriculture, they were only allowed to be involved in finance. And the reason they were allowed to be involved in finance is because the church said, you're not allowed to lend money for interest. But, you know, people realize for finance, we need to borrow money. And so the only people allowed to lend money were Jews. And so that's why they ended up getting pushed into finance. And of course, then a lot of the financial centers and banking started from Jews, you know, because they were pushed into that area.
They have names like Goldman Sachs.
Yes, situation. All sorts of things, Rothschild and, you know, all these people. Anyway, so, yeah, Marks and Spencer's, Tesco. I mean, if you just look at, if you look at the contribution of Jewish people to the British High Street, Tesco, for example. Harrods. Harrods was founded by a Jewish person. Selfridges, I think, was. And, yeah, Tesco, Marks and Sparks, a huge contribution to, anyway, that's much later, of course. But anyway, and so, yes. Anyway, so you had this anti-Semitism, and so when it came to the Nazis wanting to get rid of the Jews, then did the Christian church stand up and say no? They didn't say that. They should have felt, I am my brother's keeper. The Christian church made the same mistake that Cain made. am I my brother's keeper? Why should I look after them? But actually what should have happened is that the Christian church should have said, this is wrong. These people are not, they haven't done anything wrong. They're not murderers, they're not robbers. They're just ordinary people engaged in business and medicine and universities and judges and lawyers, you know, all sorts of people. And the Christian churches should have said to the state, this is wrong. So, for example, when somebody came along to take a Jewish family away in a lorry to the concentration camp, the next door neighbour should have said, "We're not. These are our neighbours. We know them, we trust them, we love them. We're not going to allow you to do this." And that's what the Pope should have done. This is a big gripe that people have against the Pope. The Pope should have issued a letter that should have been read in every single church throughout Europe, in every Catholic church, saying to the church, the congregation, what is happening is wrong and you should prevent this from happening. But he didn't do that. And so people felt, well, you know, they're only Jews. And if they get carted away, well, we can move into their house. We can have their property. And that's what happened. Their houses were taken away, confiscated. And even when Jewish people who survived the Holocaust came back to their home, the house was there, but somebody else had moved in and they were told to go away. And so they had nowhere to go, so they went to Israel. Anyway, so the Holocaust then is a Cain-inspired action. The whole motivation is Cain type. And the church should have protected and stopped and prevented this from happening, but they didn't do that. And so when you look at the contribution of Jewish people in Britain and, you know, around the world, most of the Nobel Prize, you know, Jews are about 0.006% of the world population are Jewish. About 40% of Nobel Prize winners are Jews. You know, when you actually look at the contribution to world culture, to world civilization, to law, to finance, to trade, to medicine, to government, to the whole of Western civilization, their contribution is extraordinary. So you have to think, well, who wanted to kill the Jews? Satan. Because he recognized this incredible contribution they made to God's providence. And, you know, you can imagine if those 6 million Jews had been killed, they'd still been around. Again, they would have made a huge contribution. Yeah. It's fascinating. Look at the people who came here as survivors out of the camps or as children. They made extraordinary contribution to British life. Anyway, so look at the extent of the Holocaust. Poland, 85% of the Jews were murdered. Out of 3 1/3 million, 2,800,000 were murdered. Soviet Union, 71%. Romania, 50%. Yeah. So out of the 8 million Jews who were living in Europe, about 6 million were murdered systematically on an industrial scale. It's, you know, it's absolutely shocking. And then some people say, well, that's what they deserved. Why should we repent? You know, that's the punishment they get for killing Jesus. But actually, you know, all the European churches should be shedding tears and apologizing, repenting for what happened, for what they allow to happen to this people living in their midst. Now, we don't get a lot of recognition or a lot of repentance from Christian churches. There's something which happened very recently. Yeah, very recently. A lot of the people who did this are still alive, are still walking the streets unpunished. They murdered tens of thousands of people, and they weren't punished. They weren't brought to trial. Just a few of the leaders are brought to trial, and most people. And so again, people who studied this, they said in order for the Holocaust to take place, millions of Germans knew about it and actually were involved in making it happen. All the people running the railways, all the people involved in this and that, all these people, they knew what was happening. But, you know, and generally speaking, they didn't say no. There are a few people who said no and they were shot. But if people had said, actually, you know, I'm not going to do this, I'm going to follow my conscience, I know this is wrong, then yes, they would have been shot. But if enough of them had said, practice civil disobedience and refuse to cooperate, Christian churches have said, we're not going to cooperate, and we're telling all our people that they should not cooperate with this, they should practice civil disobedience, then it wouldn't have happened. It couldn't have happened. It could only happen with the connivance and support and the Christian church turning, you know, a blind eye to this.
The trouble is, though, there's a conflict here because attached it.
Yes. So they went. So
they
yes.
were going with it rather than.
Well, that's right. So they gave in to the temptation to follow Hitler and his nationalistic ideas. And along with his nationalism came a hatred for the other.
Yes.
These Jews are not real Germans.
No.
We need to purify the race, this pursuit of racial purity. And we can, you know, and then it's, the whole thing's pretty horrible.
Yeah.
And it was just going on recently. But yeah, it's also interesting to see what were the attitude of a lot of the Jewish people who went through these camps. This is one example of a letter found near a dead child at Ravensbrück concentration camp. O Lord, remember not only the men and women of good will, but also those of evil will. But do not remember all the suffering they have inflicted upon us. Remember the fruits we have borne thanks to this suffering, our comradeship, our loyalty, our humility, our courage, our generosity, the greatness of heart which has grown out of all this. And when they come to judgment, let all the fruits that we have borne be their forgiveness. That's very typical of the sorts of things that people talk about, the way a lot of Jews, they went into the gas chambers, they knew where they were going, but they went there praising God. They went there offering their life, you know, and, you know, said, we don't know why this is happening to us, but we're willingly going to, you know, allow this to happen. And it did happen, the most horrendous thing. And so then it became an extraordinary condition of indemnity, you know, that God was able to claim. It's just read some of the little booklets or things about real people, how they talked about it, what happened, the sort of things they said. And it made an extraordinary condition of indemnity. Because of this kind of attitude of being willing to forgive their enemies, willing to forgive the people that are doing this to them. A lot of these people, you know, they didn't even know they were Jewish. Yeah, I mean, there's one in a program I saw. One person, he's a professor of law. He was a Christian, a Lutheran. It just so happened that one of his grandparents was a Jew. He didn't know this, and then one day he came along. He was arrested and taken by the police. He was a professor of law, very well respected. And they said, you know, did you know you had a Jewish grandmother? No, I didn't know that. First I've heard of it. Yes, you have a Jewish grandmother, so under our laws you're Jewish and we are sending you to wherever it was, one of the concentration camps.
Last week I was on holiday and I was watching Who Do You Think You Are? Mm-hmm. And they repeat, but it was Stephen Fry.
Mm.
Yeah. His grandfather was Jewish.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And there's a big plaque there
mm-hmm.
with all the people that were taken by
yeah.
the Nazis,
mm.
including his grandfather.
Yeah, it's absolutely horrendous. So these are the numbers of people Jews left in Europe afterwards. You can see, you know, just Poland, 45,000, gone down from 3 million. Staggering, you know, what happened. You know, it's just a blot. You know, of Cain murdering Abel on this huge religious scale. Anyway, so World War ended and the Soviet Union became involved because Germany decided to invade the Soviet Union, much to Stalin's surprise, shock and horror and complete lack of preparedness. And so the Soviet Union entered on the side of the Allies. And basically more people died in the Soviet armies than died in all the other armies. And so without the contribution of the Soviet Union, then it would have taken much longer to defeat Nazi Germany. In fact, without the contribution of the Soviet Union, probably wouldn't have been able to defeat Nazi Germany. Yes, it led to peace, 1945, establishing the United Nations. And this is then overcoming the second temptation. So again, as I said, you know, Germany didn't want to declare war on, but Germans didn't want to have war with Britain. You know, Hitler said, if you allow us to take over Europe, and then we'll, you know, allow you to continue to rule the world, you know, etc. And so Britain could have said, okay, we'll go along with that. That Britain was willing to go to war with Germany to protect Poland initially, and then it, you know, eventually to establish and re-establish freedom and democracy throughout Europe. And so this is why the Allies were determined this time that they were going to make Germany surrender unconditionally. Yeah. So that's why the war was extended. You know, even though they wanted to negotiate for peace, no, this time we're not going to have any claims that it was a stab in the back. This time we're going to occupy Germany and let you realize that you lost. Yeah. Anyway, so this then, this overcoming of Cain was a foundation for the Messiah to start his mission. So as you know, Father was born in Korea in 1920 on the foundation of the condition of indemnity made in Europe of Cain, of Abel overcoming Cain, the incredible sacrifice of blood, you know, for the Messiah could be born. Again, this incredible sacrifice, you know, of to overcome Satan's side and not to give in to his temptations, the condition necessary for the Messiah to be able to start his mission. And it's also a condition which led to the establishment of the State of Israel. So again, without the Holocaust, without the Holocaust, there probably wouldn't have been establishment of the State of Israel, partly because people wouldn't have wanted it, but also, the Jews would have, they're happily living in Europe at that time. Why should they want to go and live there? But because of what happened in Europe, they didn't want to live in Europe, and so they packed their bags and went to live in Israel. Because they felt, we're not safe anywhere. Anyway, so then also we had what we call this Third World War, which is an ideological conflict between communism and the liberal democracy and the free market. You've got two basic sides, more of an ideological confrontation, whereas the First World War was, a different level. Second World War was more to do with race and Nazism. Third World War was more to do with ideology and, different ways of organizing the economy, basically. The communist way of organizing the economy where the state owns everything, there's no private property. And the alternative, which is liberal democracy and the free market and private property. And anyway, so I had this little discussion here between Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin. A bit tired.
Stalin and Roosevelt have got much better posture than Churchill.
Well, Churchill was a lot older, if I remember. Much more than that, I think. And anyway, so this is at Yalta. This is where the map was drawn to divide Europe into two. And the suggestion to divide Europe into two was Churchill's, as far as I understand. And the basic reason was that Churchill knew Stalin very well. He understood communism very well. He understood the vision of communism was to establish worldwide communism. He also understood the communists then, they wanted to export communism throughout Europe. Churchill also realized that the Americans didn't particularly want to stay in Europe and they were going to withdraw from Europe. And so Churchill realized if the Americans leave Europe, who's going to stop the Soviet tanks and the Red Army rolling on all the way throughout Europe? And so Churchill came up with a cunning plan and thought, well, let's split it between the two of us. And so Stalin was willing to go along with that. And so, Eastern Europe came under the dominion and the influence of the Soviet Union, and Western Europe remained under the dominion of America and Britain. So it was,
And the Berlin Wall.
Yeah, and the Berlin Wall came later. And the So that's why it was divided like that. So it's Third World War, it's sort of a false Messiah, again. Stalin, you could say, is a false Adam. Attempt to realize the three blessings centered on an evil purpose. So, again, you had a lot of this personality cult. Instead of worshipping Hitler, people would be worshipping Stalin, as the one who brings, all the goodness in the world.
Yes. Why was there this huge
wall to stop people from escaping? It's a huge prison camp to stop people from escaping. People wanted to escape from the communist world to the free world. And so the wall and the fences were there to prevent people from escaping. The Soviet Union and the whole of the Soviet bloc was a vast prison camp.
Right.
People weren't allowed to travel and leave the country, because they probably wouldn't come back.
that.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I mean, the wall went straight through houses sometimes. And, anyway, so here you've got the sort of multiplication, trying to get everybody to be good communists, an ideological multiplication, not a racial one, but trying to convert everybody to indoctrinate them into Marxism, Leninism. And in terms of dominion, it's very much about world communism and very much about a different way of running the economy. Yeah. The state owning and controlling everything and planning everything. Anyway, so the things moved on. Stalin died, and you know, one can talk about Kim Il-sung becoming this replacement, a sort of false Adam. He was the former dictator of North Korea. He had rather sort of ideas. Anyway, didn't talk ill of the dead, should we really? Not that's restrained me up until now. What did he die of? Old age, I think. I mean, as far as I know, I don't know. I don't think. I mean, there wouldn't have been an autopsy and a coroner's report. You can be sure of that. Anyway, so again, you got this sort of World War III then going on in the East. You got South Korea on the able side, Japan, the E position this time, on the able side, and the United States of America is like the archangel on God's side. On Kane's side, you've got North Korea, and E position, you've got China, and archangel position, you've got the USSR. And so that was the sort of Cold War period. These two, you know, these two blocks. And then in the West, you had, you could say, in Europe, you had, you know, West Germany, and on Adam's side, East Germany, Kane's side, United Kingdom, USA. I don't know, still trying to work this one out, really. But anyway, there was this division in the East, in the West as well. And so the nature of this conflict depends a lot upon human responsibility. So it doesn't have to be a military conflict. There were First and Second World Wars turned out to be military conflicts. Whether it be possible to not for them not to be military conflicts, I don't know. People often say the First World War was just a disaster waiting to happen. The Second World War, well, some people say, well, you know, Britain could have prevented it from happening if they'd, you know, removed Hitler from power. But it's hard to imagine how this could have been possible. You know, Britain was a free country, a democratic country. People don't vote for war in democratic countries. So there's, you know, very little actually that Britain could have done, you know, to prevent Hitler from coming to power. You know, the reason why Hitler came to power is because the responsibility of the German people elected him. He won a huge proportion of the popular vote. And then he, you know, various sort of things, he burnt down the Reichstag, of the parliament, and he seized power. You know, it wasn't that he wasn't a popular person, he was hugely popular. So on what basis could Britain have said, well, actually, you know, Hitler's a bad man, you know, we think you should replace him with somebody else. But we elected him, you know. You know, just because you're a democracy doesn't mean you're going to elect the right person, a good person. Anyway, so the Third World War then, you know, it could have become a military conflict. People worried it might turn into a nuclear war, the Cuba crisis, the Berlin crisis, you know, crises in different places. But usually this war was fought by proxy, except for the Korean War. That was a hot war, and also in Vietnam as well. Again, they were proxy wars, more or less. It's interesting, you know, from the end of the First World War to the beginning of the Second World Wars, it's 21 years, quite interesting. The end of the Second World War to the beginning of the Vietnam War is another 21 years, started in 1966. Don't know if it means anything, but. And so this Cain and Abel struggle, how it's resolved, whether it's through a military conflict or through an ideological conflict, depends a lot upon how people respond and react. Anyway, so you have this ideological Cold War, and basically, the West defended itself. And so there were lots of temptations. For example, if you remember the CND movement, let's declare unilateral disarmament and all these things. So again, a lot of them were funded and supported by the Soviet Union. You know, a lot of communist activity at that time with the trade unions and other places to try and subvert the West. And then Mrs. Thatcher, she, you know, took a very, you know, hard line against communism, and then Reagan did as well. And so the West then didn't give in to this temptation. They just stood up. They didn't attack the Soviet Union. You know, they just stood very firm. And so eventually the communist system, which is a false system, it eventually it collapsed. and it failed. The whole thing fell apart. Well, it's a war between the free world, the democratic world, and the communist world. But it wasn't a hot war in the sense there was never a clash between Russia, between the Soviet Union and America directly, because that would have led to a nuclear war probably. So people say it's a cold war because there was just as a power struggle, and lots of things were fought out in Africa, for example, and in Southeast Asia and the Middle East, and so. You know, Russia originally, the Soviet Union originally was on the side of Israel. Well, then later they decided to support Egypt, and then America came in to support Israel. And so Russia supported Arab countries, and Israel and America supported Israel.
So there's a lot of mistrust.
A huge amount. Often quite rightly so, to be honest. You know, people were just trying to take advantage. And if one showed weakness, then one would be taken advantage of. Anyway, the communist system couldn't work because it's very unprincipled, all based upon planning. No private property, no free market, you know, no freedom of religion or anything. So eventually the whole thing just fell apart. It collapsed. And, you know, then the whole thing fell apart. And so this meant the possibility of the restoration of the third blessing and beginning of God's peaceful, ideal world. So I remember 1988, when all these things, when the Berlin Wall came down, all these things fell apart and Eastern Europe became free and all these countries became independent, they could, you know, democracy came, you know, generally quite peacefully. I mean, there were, you know, a few people were killed, Ceausescu's, but generally it was a peaceful revolutions, a peaceful transition from communism to democracy. Lots of problems, lots of corruption, lots of dreadful things. The same, Russia had changed. The whole Soviet Union peacefully disintegrated into its bits. Russia peacefully changed from being a communist system to being a democratic system. You know, there, again, there were problems, the odd coup attempt and here and there, but generally speaking, when you look at it, it's extraordinary that a whole system just fell apart peacefully instead of a coup d'etat, instead of a civil war. Sorry? Yeah, just the right people happened to appear at the right times, Gorbachev and Yeltsin and, you know, even Putin. You're relatively, when you look at the history and you think that these people are relatively pretty good considering the system in which they grew up and out of which they came. They could have been absolutely and utterly horrendous. But, you know, the whole of it, anyway, it's just an incredible peaceful change. It was just a miracle. You know, people thought, may degenerate into civil war, but it didn't. It's a remarkable, in that sense, like expression of God's grace, this incredible, peaceful, you know, resolution of this Cain and Abel problem. Didn't need to have this war like we did with Hitler, you know, or with Germany. It just peacefully, the whole thing just fell apart. You know, because, and then the thing is that when it happened, then America didn't take advantage. You know, when the Soviet Union fell apart, then America would have said, right, we're going to invade you now and we can wipe you out. We can invade and we can win. But they didn't do that. The West just actually supported Russia. So when the whole thing fell apart and the food system collapsed and the distribution system collapsed, then America sent lots and lots of food aid to feed the Russians. Lots of turkey legs in particular, the Russians remembered. Vast amounts of food aid. So it's again like Abel serving Cain. You know, not taking advantage of the situation, not making the same mistake as they made in the First World War, you know, taking advantage of Germany. But this time, it's a different kind of attitude.
Being a brother.
Yes, being a good brother. Mm-hmm. And so that, you know, worked out pretty well. That was in the, you know, the sort of the Western side, the European side. But then you get this sort of, you know, it's not still not sorted out. So we've got what's going on at the moment today. This is more sort of conflict, you know, almost on a religious scale. So in Korea, you've still got this problem. You've got North Korea, which is still a Stalinistic state. Kim Il-sung died, his son is now, you know, the dictator, and he's hoping his son becomes the next dictator. It's the most, anyway, probably the worst place in the world to live. Millions of people died in famines. And the whole huge proportion of the economy is orientated towards the development of missile technology, nuclear weapons. It has the largest army in the world. You look at it on the map, it's only a little place, but it has the largest army in the world.
It's amazing, isn't
extraordinary in terms of proportion of the population that are militarized. And then, you read the newspapers today and you see that, another place where there's a lot of conflict is in the Middle East, Israel-Palestine. Again, it's a huge unresolved issue. And the interesting thing is, you might wonder, well, what's going on in Israel-Palestine? Well, there's some people who don't want Israel to exist, and want to remove Israel from the face of the map. And in Gaza, there's a group, Hamas, who've been sending missiles into Israel, tens of thousands of missiles, also from Hezbollah, from Lebanon, did as well. It's tens of thousands of missiles being lobbied in. You might wonder, where does this missile technology come from? Not Iraq, it comes from Iran and Syria. But then you might wonder, where does Iran and Syria get their missile technology from and their nuclear technology? No. They get it from North Korea. So, for example, not very long, I think last year, Israel destroyed a nuclear power plant in Syria, which was being built by the North Koreans, and lots of North Koreans were killed, and North Koreans got really upset. That all their people were being killed, and thought, why are the North Koreans building a nuclear power plant in Syria? And then a lot of the missile technology, which comes from Syria, from North Korea, gets sent to Iran and passed on from there to Syria and also to arm Hezbollah and Hamas. And so when you think about it, what's this funny little country called North Korea doing trying to destroy Israel? It's interesting that, Korea is the place to which the Messiah should be born, the chosen nation. But Korea is divided into two. So you've got North Korea, the communist part of God's chosen nation, trying to destroy Israel, God's first chosen nation, chosen people. Yeah. And then allied then with the Muslim bloc. So Islamist extremists, not saying all Muslims, but if you look at Iran, it's trying to, and large parts of it, the Arab world, want to try and eliminate Israel and would be quite happy to eliminate the Jews. And so that's the descendants of Ishmael, trying to destroy Isaac.
I can't understand why in North Korea the communist idealism hasn't collapsed along with Russia and China.
It's much, much stricter control of their society. And it's well, it's in East Germany. The East Germans watch West German television. They were under no illusions that, what things were like. Russians listened to the World Service and they could also, and they understood what was going on in the West. Whereas the North Koreans, they haven't got a clue.
No internet.
There's no internet, no television, foreign television, no foreign radio. They're propaganda telling them that they're the most advanced country in the entire world. And they believe it. It's a bit of a shock to the system when they go somewhere else. Anyway, so you got this alliance. Right.
I heard five of their players have gone missing.
So. Oh, gosh, really?
I don't know, maybe it's just a rumour.
Yes, that's, I can't imagine they wouldn't suffer. Anyway, they did lots of bad stuff. So you have here on Satan's side, you've got all the historical Keynes lined up on Satan's side from communism. In North Korea, it's more or less the divine right of kings, except they don't believe in God, they believe in funny stuff going on there, sort of monarchy. And then you got lined up with a sort of Islamist kind of world and connected to Palestine. And then on the able side, well, there should be Israel, the Christian bloc, and South Korea. And so traditionally, then Europe and Britain in particular gave birth to Israel. Britain as a mother country gave birth to America as the second Israel. Britain in 1948 as a mother country gave birth to Israel, in Israel. And Britain also should have occupied, Korea and made Korea part of his empire. But that was a mistake. It didn't work out for various reasons. And so Britain didn't give birth to Korea and they've been suffering from it ever since. Anyway, so you've got this alliance then. So there should be this support between Israel, the Christian world, America, and
South Korea or England?
The Koreans. Well, yes. Anyway, that's, you can read my blog if you want to, an exposition of that.
What do you mean by Christian blog?
Well, okay, Christian blog. This is the Christian world of America and Europe. It should be supporting. So Israel, you've got the first Israel, you've got the second Israel, which is the Christianity, and you have the third Israel, which is Korea, South Korea. You don't want to come and listen to my exposition of geopolitics, do you, Robin? Anyway, so you got Satan's got all his, you know, his side lined up, all working together. North Korea, you know, Syria, Iran, you know, supporting Hezbollah and Hamas. And on God's side, you got the first Israel, second Israel, Christianity, and third Israel, represented by South Korea. And they should also be lined up and supporting each other. Anyway, so the support for Israel is declining in Europe, continental Europe. There's not a lot of support now for Israel. And Britain also is wavering. William Haines taking a more pro-Palestinian stance than is normal within British politics. And so Britain also is withdrawing from its support from Israel. And America under Obama also is withdrawing its support from Israel. Sorry? Well, if that happens, then Israel will be removed. And Israel's only there because it's been protected by America.
And it's getting all its weapons.
Well, yeah, that's right. Well, Israel, I mean, it makes a lot of its own weapons, but yes, it gets a huge amount of support from America.
Yeah.
Yes, if it wasn't being protected by America, then it would have been destroyed in 1948. Or 1967 or 1973.
So again, this is such a contradiction, because it was America that was always trying to get the two sides to be peaceful, and yet America was aiding and giving Israel weapons.
Well, that's right. Well, it's giving Israel
weapons.
No, it's giving Israel weapons so that Israel can defend itself. Israel hasn't actually started any of the wars.
No.
It hasn't invaded any of these countries. It's been attacked and invaded itself, so it needs the weapons to defend itself. Well, that's just the reality. You know, every people, every country, everybody has a right to defend themselves. And as I said, you know, when you look at it, Israel wasn't... In 1948, the United Nations drew up a two-state solution. Israel, the Jews were going to be given, you know, small bits along the Mediterranean Sea where they were living, a few other bits here and there. And the Jews said, we're happy with this. That's fine. But the Arab countries said, no, we're not going to allow the Jews to have anything, even these little areas. And so in 1948, the Arab nations, they invaded Israel and tried to prevent this two-state solution coming about. The Israelis, they were able to defeat the Arab armies, and actually the result was that Israel, the land that was Jewish then, expanded to basically the boundaries of Israel that people recognize today. But actually, the boundaries of Israel you see today, if the Arab armies hadn't tried to destroy Israel, it would only be a fraction of the size it is today. And then they lived within those boundaries up until 1967. In 1967, they were attacked again. And so what is now Gaza, that was part of Egypt. That was administered by Egypt. What is now the West Bank was administered by Jordan, not by Israel. And Israel had no desire to be in Gaza or the West Bank. But then, again, there was a war. They were attacked by the Egyptians, the Syrians, and by the Jordanians. And again, this time Israel defeated the Egyptians, the Jordanians, the Syrians. And part of defeating the Egyptians, Israel occupied the whole of the Sinai, including Gaza, because it defeated Egypt and the Egyptians withdrew. The Jordanians left the West Bank. Israel wasn't planning to occupy the West Bank, but when they occupied the whole of Jerusalem, the other half of Jerusalem they didn't have, the old city, then they realized that the Jordanians had completely withdrawn from the West Bank. And so they thought, well, they've crossed over the river Jordan. So, you know, without any particular plan, some Israeli army commanders, they sort of occupied the West Bank. Anyway, so after, this is 1967. Then after this, then Israel wanted to make peace with Egypt and with Jordan. And part of the peace deal was Israel wanted to give this land back to Egypt and to Jordan. And so eventually the peace deal was made with Egypt, and the Sinai Desert was given back to Egypt. But Egypt didn't want Gaza, and they left Gaza under Israeli occupation. The Israelis did not want Gaza, but the Egyptians didn't want it either. And so, because they were, the people living there were Palestinians, not Egyptians, and they didn't want Palestinians living in Egypt. They didn't want to, you know, administer them. They didn't want to take responsibility for them, even though they were all Arabs. They spoke Arabic. Most of them were Muslims. But the Egyptians said, you know, we don't want Gaza. We don't want the responsibility of administering Gaza, because it wasn't part of Egypt. And then when Israel made peace with Jordan, Jordan did not want the West Bank back. They didn't want it back. And so Israel was left administering West Bank and Gaza. It was not, in that sense, Israel's been treated really unfairly. They didn't want these bits of land. They only ended up occupying them because they'd been attacked. They wanted to give them back, but the people didn't want them. So they ended up having to, they ended up under international law having to administer them, which they didn't want them. And then for years, nothing happened. They just administered them, hoping that, you know, one day the Jordanians, Jordan would want the West Bank back, but it didn't. And then many years later, then some Israeli settlers started to go and buy land, and started to settle there. And gradually over the years, a settlement started to increase. You know, it's just very unfortunate it happened. So the point is that when Gaza and the West Bank were occupied by Egypt and Jordan, those two countries then had the opportunity to establish a Palestinian state, but they didn't do it.
Couldn't Israel have established it?
No, because Israel is a Jewish state. You know, they didn't want the land. But they
so
were
they could have given it to the people living there?
Well, yes, but there was no internal government, there was nothing, it was just a very difficult situation. You know, and then gradually more and more people started settling there. And it was just very, very messy, that's all. And I just feel sorry for them, to be honest. You know, I think the Arab countries should have taken responsibility for them. Mm-hmm. So, you know, these are all Arabs and mostly Muslims living in the Palestinian lands. And the Arab countries, they're not poor. They have a phenomenal amount of money from oil, which they could invest in the economy there, but they don't. You know, huge problems. And people say, why don't the Israelis do this, that, and the other? Well, you know.
Why doesn't the Arab nations do it?
He's saying, why don't the Arabs take care of them? Because they're Arabs living there. You know, they're the natural people you would expect, you know, to you know, be helping them. Yeah. I remember when Bishop Ria, do you know Bishop Ria?
Yes.
Yeah. I went to listen to a talk he gave to a Muslim group here, and explaining what was going on in Israel. And he's explaining about the Palestinian schools that he was running. And he's explaining that most of the children who went to these Palestinians, most of the children who went to these Church of England schools that he was setting up and running were Muslims. But he said none of the money to run these schools for Muslims comes from Muslim countries. This money's being contributed by Christians. And he said, why don't the Muslims contribute some money towards the improvement of the Palestinian school system and education? But they don't. A huge amount of money comes from the European Union to improve the situation in Palestine. Mm-hmm. Huge amount of money comes, you know, from America. A lot of Israel actually does a huge amount in investing in the infrastructure of the Palestinian territories. You know, but Arab countries don't. You have to think, why? Why is this the case? There's a problem here. You know, people don't address, they don't ask these questions. Anyway, so I said you've got this able stream of history, and it's very important for God's providence is the unity of the first, second, and third Israels. This is fundamental. Yeah? But the problem is in South Korea, there's a huge amount of anti-Semitism. There's not much, because there's, you know, the Christian anti-Semitism in the Christian church, you find not just in Europe, European churches of changed their policy towards the Jews. In 1964, they said anti-Semitism is a mistake. But, you know, a lot of Christians who went to South Korea, they've inherited the sort of traditional European anti-Semitism. So when you read the New Testament, it looks like Jesus against the Jews. You know, people don't usually recognize Jesus was a Jew. It's all part of a Jewish conversation. It always looks like the Jews were ganging up upon Jesus. Yeah? If you read the New Testament in a naive way, an uneducated way. And so this is a huge problem. So, for example, when the president of Israel, Shimon Peres, when he went to visit Korea very recently, then, you know, it was supposed to be a state visit, but then it was downgraded to just an ordinary visit. Why? This is just after the flotilla incident, because the South Koreans didn't want to upset Arab countries. Because South Korea has a huge amount of investment in the Gulf, in the Middle East, in oil production, heavy industry, machine tools, tractors, and he has huge machines. South Korea's got huge economic interests in the Arab countries. And so again, it's a temptation. You know, which way is South Korea going to go? Is it going to do the right thing and support Israel, even if it means upsetting their economics? Or they're going to say, well, yes, Israel is a democratic country, but we're not going to stand by Israel because we want to protect our economy. And you have to look, what did Britain do in the First and Second World Wars? Britain did the right thing, even though it bankrupted us. And so Korea, South Korea, also has to ask itself, is it going to do the right thing and stand by Israel? Or is it going to... So, for example, when Israel wanted to open an embassy in South Korea, the South Koreans didn't want it to start with, because they're afraid if we allow Israel to set up an embassy in South Korea, then the Arab countries are going to be upset with us, and we might lose some contracts. You know, that's thinking a very pragmatic way, you know, just thinking in terms of the economy, as opposed to thinking what is the right thing to do. Israel is the only democratic country in the whole of the Middle East. Proper democracy. It's the only country in the whole of the Middle East with a free press. It's the only country in the whole of the Middle East with the rule of law and independent judiciary. It's the only country in the whole of the Middle East which is functioning on Western lines. Yeah? So if the West isn't prepared to defend Israel, then the West isn't prepared to defend itself. And again, if you look at the contribution of Judaism and Jews to world culture and civilization, these are, in many ways, you know, God's chosen people. The contribution they made has been massive and immense. And so it's the responsibility of the second and third Israels to protect the first Israel. Because if you haven't got this unity, and Israel goes, then, you know, the whole world will go, in that sense, going along that lines, yeah? Mm-hmm. What happens then when Iran gets the nuclear weapons, and Syria, and the jihad? You know, it's not difficult to work out the way in which things are going. Yeah. So you get this global clash of civilizations then. It's a continuation of the Third World War, which hasn't yet finished. It's just got different members on Satan's side, and God's side also needs to get its act sorted out. So you might wonder, what are these, what is this Al-Qaeda, you know, the Islamic critique of Western society? So this is from Osama bin Laden's letter after 9/11, you know, which is just one episode in this global jihad, which has restarted, which stopped going forwards in 69 or something, 89 I think it was. Anyway, this is what Osama bin Laden said: "We call you, America, the West. We call you to stop your oppression, lies, immorality, the debauchery that spread among you. We call you to be people of manners, principles, honor, and purity, to reject the immoral acts of fornication, homosexuality, intoxication, gambling, and trading with interest." So when Muslims look at what goes on in the Western world, they're absolutely appalled and shocked by these sorts of things that are going on. So this is completely and utterly outrageous and wrong, and it has to change. And so, you know, nobody here remembers Mary Whitehouse?
Yeah.
Oh, Joyce, of course, the same generation. Oh, yes, of course. Anyway, so you remember Mary Whitehouse tried to clean up the press, you know, about all this rubbish, all this bad stuff going on in the media and everything. So Al-Qaeda is like Mary Whitehouse with a machine gun. You know, there was this impetus within the Christian church to stop this kind of corruption from taking place. Muslims, instead of working through the legal system like Mary Whitehouse to try and bring about peaceful change, sometimes they feel the only way to do it is to take up arms and, you know, go and blow up and destroy this or destroy that or destroy that. Incredible frustration, incredible sense that the world is full of evil and all these evil things are going on, we can't stop them. So, you know.
A lot of Muslims would say to you that, they are not Muslims.
They are Muslims.
They are not real Muslims, the ones who...
Well, I go along...
You just sort of made quite a generalisation.
Well, the people who do this, they call themselves Muslims. They went to the mosque, they studied the Quran. They are Muslims. They're not... You know, if they describe themselves as Muslims, I'm quite happy for them to accept that definition. And the other thing is when you read opinion polls, you find that huge proportions of the Muslim population support them. You know, the fish only swims when there's water. Otherwise, all these people would have been handed over to the authorities, but they weren't, you know. She was right.
She was right.
Yeah, she was. But anyway, so this is this whole thing. You know,
but let's not say that Al-Qaeda's particularly right.
No, well, it's very interesting. If you read their critique of American and Western society, one can't fault it. They point every single thing that is wrong. One can't disagree with their analysis of what's wrong with Western society. All one can say is they don't have the solution.
But isn't that the essence of this kind of principle, this concept in the divine principle, that this relationship between Cain and Abel is that Abel is meant to be able to bring Cain close to God, but Cain being frustrated by Abel's lack of real Abel character or good character.
But at the end of the day, murder is never sin. There's no justification for sin. Cain murdered Abel, but without any justification whatsoever. It's completely and utterly wrong to justify Cain's murder of Abel. It doesn't matter how arrogant Abel was. That's no excuse for killing somebody. It doesn't matter how badly Abel might have behaved. There's no excuse for murder. You can't go into a court in this country and say, "Oh, so-and-so behaved really arrogantly to me, and that's why I killed him, you know, I'm justified." There's no justification for sin. You know? It doesn't matter how badly the God side or behaves in that sense, murder is always without justification.
I think this is one of those contradictions in the rules, because homosexuality, I mean, that's rife worldwide, it's not just the West.
I'm not saying, yes, I know, but they keep it to themselves.
And, you know, there's contradictions along the way, because they say you do this,
of course, they wouldn't claim that Muslim society is perfect at all, and so...
I'm not suggesting that they are, but saying that, clean your own house before you pick on other people's houses.
Yes, not denying that, but I'm just saying this is their analysis, and they feel that, you know, they've been called by God to proclaim Islam, and they feel that Islam has been rejected, and so then they have to, you know, impose Islam, and they feel justified in their interpretation of the Quran that this is what they should do. So looking at Quranic Muslim history and the Quran, it's not difficult to find precedents for the things that they're doing within Islamic history. A lot of this sort of thing has happened, you know, things not unlike this in the past. Anyway, so I said that's his part of his analysis. Very interesting to read it. And so, yes, you know, the Western world needs to clean itself up. It needs to be a moral, spiritual moral renewal within Israel, America, and elsewhere. It needs to be, yes. And if there isn't, then, you know, it's quite possible that the Cain sides will win. Yes, it's worldwide, yeah. Anyway, I've finished if it's any consolation, so. I've finished if it's any consolation. That's okay. You have to go, yeah.
Have a
get the train, yeah. Okay.
Sorry.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
Anyway, so, you know, when I think about this, I'm, you know, think about this situation here, I think, well, okay, what should happen? So when Shimon Peres went to South Korea, then of course there were lots of people demonstrating against Israel. I don't know why the South Koreans should be demonstrating against Israel, but anyway they were, because there's a lot of anti-Semitism around. Okay, so what should the Unification Church be doing in this situation in South Korea, do you think?
Supporting the Israeli Prime Minister.
Yes. So to unite the first and second and third Israels, the Unification Church in South Korea, and all the CARP members, they should have been going out demonstrating in support of Israel and Shimon Peres and saying, welcome, we love Israel. What do you think Shimon Peres would have thought? It would have been the first time in human history that people who weren't Jews demonstrated in favor of Israel. He would have been absolutely and utterly shocked. I want to know, who are these weirdos? Who are these peculiar people that, you know, who aren't Jews but still love Israel and demonstrating in favor of Israel and demonstrating against the people who are demonstrating against Israel? So, you know, as a unification movement, as conceptualized and sees itself as a third or fourth Israel or fifth, one starts to lose track of these things after a while, it needs to demonstrate unity. So just as, you know, we used to demonstrate against communism, we should be demonstrating today to support in support of Israel. The first and second, third Israels need to be united. And so I think that's what the Unification Church in South Korea should have been doing a couple of weeks ago. But personally, I don't think they think about this. That's just the way I think.
They've got other issues.
They've got other issues which they're dealing with. They're getting navel gazing and, you know, looking at all sorts of internal.
Well, that, but then there's that issue with the ship thing.
Well, again, you have to. So again, you have to see what's going on here. I mean, the reason why there's a blockade, the reason why Israel has a blockade is to stop a naval blockade is to stop weapons from being taken into Gaza. Unless Israel stops the ships and searches them, then weapons can go into Gaza. A lot of humanitarian aid is pouring in all the time through the Israeli border with Palestine, with Gaza, or food aid and all this sort of aid is going in all the time, trucks loads of it. You know, if the Egyptians open their border, then there'd be trucks loads of humanitarian aid going from the Egyptian side as well. But Israel has a naval blockade against Gaza because it knows that Hamas want to import missile technology and armaments. And Israel isn't in Gaza. There are no Israeli soldiers. Well, there's only one Israeli soldier in Gaza. You know, if a ship lands in Gaza, then Israel can't check to see what's going on. That's why Israel has a naval blockade. So by sending this flotilla along to break the blockade, it's saying we should allow armaments to go into Gaza to arm Hamas so they can have bigger missiles, much bigger missiles, and then they can wipe out the Jews. And so this flotilla was to break the blockade. That's what it's all about, just to break the blockade, so apparently to bring humanitarian aid, and there was humanitarian aid, but if the blockade was broken, then the ships that would have come later would have been had armaments from North Korea. And so, you know, when the Israelis, there were seven ships, I think, they landed on six of these ships and peacefully, you know, they were able to steer these ships away back to Haifa or wherever they went. But on one of the ships, then they were attacked. And you probably saw the video of, you know, the individual soldiers coming down. They're completely incompetent, the Israelis, when it comes to this. You know, just a couple of soldiers went down one at a time, and there was a mob of people there with iron bars attacking them and seizing their pistols. You can see some of the faces of the Israeli soldiers. They were really badly blooded. And so to protect themselves, defend themselves, then, some Israeli soldiers took out their handguns. They only had pistols. They didn't have rifles. They took out their pistols and they shot some of these people that were trying to murder these Israeli soldiers. And some of these people, so-called peaceniks, they made little martyrdom videos in Turkey before they left. Because they knew if this happens to us, this will create incredible publicity against Israel. Yeah? So instead of going along and blowing myself up as a suicide bomber, in Haifa or somewhere, if I can go along and get myself killed by an Israeli soldier.
So they're anti-Israeli rather than pro-Palestinian, as well as being pro-Palestinian?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Both, yeah. Some of these people were anti-Israeli and pro-Palestinian. And anyway, so that's what happened. And so it's incredibly irresponsible for Turkey to send these ships over to break this naval blockade, thinking about what the consequences are going to be. So Israel, again, was put in an impossible situation. Either it allows them to go through and the blockade to be broken, in which case they're going to be destroyed in the long term when all the heavy missiles come in, or they stop the blockade, or they stop the ships from coming themselves, but then they get attacked, it becomes a hostage of fortune, and they get the blame in the world affairs. What should have happened? Somebody else should have gone along and intercepted the blockade. Why didn't Britain do it? Why didn't America do it? Why didn't the Christian churches support them? Why is it the Jews, the Israelis, have been having to deal with this situation themselves of Hamas, Gaza, the Palestinians? Why isn't the world becoming actively involved in trying to sort this problem out? They're not.
Tony Blair is.
Yeah, Tony Blair, oh gosh. The man's a war criminal. Sorry, excuse me, delete. Invading Iraq with no justification whatsoever. You know, the invasion of Iraq was illegal, immoral, a strategic blunder. You know, I personally think he should be, you know, go to The Hague and...
He's a peace envoy. Now.
Oh, I mean, I just don't want to talk about him. But anyway, it's just unfair, the fact that this sort of Israel is expected to deal with this situation itself. It's unfair that, you know, other people aren't dealing with Hamas and Hezbollah. Anyway, my 2 hours is up. I'll stop. Thank you.
So next week is...
Oh, I suppose the second Advent, I guess.
Thank you, William.
Thank you. Thank you very much for coming along, giving me this chance to talk. Wow. I haven't said it.
Quite a journey, yeah? Oh, yeah. That's the workshop, basically.
Yeah. Any questions?
They're having a Skype chat.
No,
as
Skype chat.
Going along.
Okay. Hi, everybody.
Is it? You turned it off already?
No.
Oh, still on?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Now, I must say, it's really nice to study the principle in a way when you're sort of, when there's kind of reference to modern geopolitical situations and strong opinions expressed as well.
Oh, I want to get people to think.
Yeah.
Katrina said that I agree
with you. Who said that?
Katrina.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
She agrees with Simon. She isn't going to say agree with me though.
What's his name? Michael Gove, the education secretary? We'll email it to him, the link. For the national curriculum.
No, it's embarrassing.
Matthew is asking, what is the next topic?
The second advent. In other words,
Christ.
Second advent of Christ. How will he come? Where will he be born? Which I guess is the last lecture, really, isn't it? In the series.
So it's Monday again. Is it next Monday again?
Sorry, I didn't get to meet you. My name is William. Carmelita. Okay.
My sister, Simeone.
What was your name then?
Simeone.
That's very nice. Where are you from?
Nice to see you.
The Philippines. Oh, wow, wonderful.
Yeah.
Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Brenda.
We are connected to East London.
Okay.
Marva's church in East London.
Marcus's?
Marva.
Marva. Oh, okay, Marva. Yes, I know Marva. Good. That is nice to meet you.
It's nice to listen to you.
Oh, thanks for coming.
Good. More additional knowledge.
Okay, see you, Brenda.
Bye, Brenda.
Nice.
See you.
Safe journey home.
Thank you.
lovely, isn't it, when it's so light at this time of the night. It's great. Wonderful. Enjoy the summer late nights.
That would jump the end up there. Will it? First ever thunder.
Are they practicing?
Who is?
Are they practicing, actually?
I don't know. How does everyone feel about the new chairs?
It's a bit hard with long-term sitting.
Oh, yeah? Mm-hmm.